Yeah, so first, just a bit of linear algebra. Assume that you have it's here. So let's consider the matrix that belongs to the tensor product to this two matrix algebra with dimension d1 and c2. And let's define the operation, okay, just denote by T the operation, just transposition of matrices from the second factor. And then you lift this operation to the whole matrix, this tensor product, just as identity on the first and the transposition the second. And then the new matrix that you obtain by applying this, so to say, map, we will denote like that. And it's called partial transpose. So if you write in standard matrix form, of course, you use two indexes. Instead of one, you use two. So the first space will be indexed by Latin characters and the second space by Greek. And if we have the our matrix, then the partial transpose, you just interchange alpha and beta. So this is a matrix of just matrix form of this operation. Yeah. There is another interpretation. Just fix the first indices j and k, and then running the second two, you'll have a block number. What is going on? It's too fast. Just it's already the end. I don't know what happened. How to go to the. Excuse me. Yes. So you have the block number jk, and you just transpose in every. You replace every block by transposed block, and you will get new matrix. So you can not necessarily speak in terms of tensor product. Just you can replace all this terminology just by block. By viewing this as a block matrices. Okay. And now, why it is important? Why this operation somehow now is rather popular? Because let's consider the positive definite matrix. And then it is very easy to prove that in general, if you have positive definite matrix and you apply this operation, the obtained matrix will not be positive, definite. But if yes, we say that this matrix S is positive. So just this matrix called partial transpose, and if it has this property, we say the positive partial transpose, PPT. And why it is important? Because if you pass to the quantum statistical mechanics or more fashionable to quantum informatics, then positive definite matrix. What is going on? I do nothing, I just keep it. My God. It goes every time to the end. Yeah, if I okay. Thanks, yes, just a moment. My God. Here. Okay, thanks. No. Okay, thanks. Yes. So, and there is an important question. Assume that, as it was before, that I view my initial space as a tensor product of two, and then it is easy to check that if our matrix MN is a tensor product, then this implication is valid. So if initial matrix is positive definite, then the partial transpose is also positive definite. And then by just negation, you find the criterion, the sufficient condition when your matrix is not positive partial transpose. Is not separable, excuse me, is not representable as a is a tensor product. This is in the case when the partial transpose is not positive definite.
But it's not if and only if.
Sorry?
It's not if and only if.
No, it's sufficient conditions. There are many counterexamples. But why it is important? Because if your density matrix is a tensor product of matrix of then this state is not entangled. Therefore, and the entanglement is an important notion. And it's important to have certain criterion efficient enough to conclude that your matrix is entangled. So your state, which this density matrix present, is entangled. And this is very simple. In fact, this is a proof. Very simple criterion was given by Peres in 96. And to my knowledge, this is most efficient, despite, of course, it's sufficient. Sorry? No, it's not you. Well, it's another Peres. It's a physicist. I forgot the initial, the name. The paper was Fizerev Letters. As far as I know, Yuval Peres never published in Fizerev Letters. And not A. Peres, which is... No, okay, I have to look. I just forgot. No, it is just different community. I would like to say just that. And since we accept that this is good criterion, then we go the route to the spectral series. So we have to study the spectrum of our partial transpose to conclude whether the spectrum contains negative eigenvalues. And this is all. So we get a nice and well-posed problem of spectral theory. And of course, and we know, all of us, that a very good, so to say, witness, okay, let me go. Okay, so, and now, since we're about positive definite matrices, of course, we recall ourselves the random matrix theory, where the typical, so to say, typical positive definite matrix, this is just of that form. You take a rectangular matrix N by M, and you multiply by conjugate, and you get, as we all believe in random matrix theory, this is generic positive definite matrix. There is no more justification, but well. So let us study as a positive definite matrix, the positive definite matrix of that form with random X, which is in statistics, this matrix X called the data matrix because this is sample covariance, in fact, matrix in statistics. And this is, again, matrix form if we are dealing with tensor products, then we have to write this in this form. So this is J alpha, this K beta, and tau, this index by, okay, for the columns. And of course, the simplest case when X's are Gaussian, either real, this is called Wishart, or complex, that's called Laguerre in random matrix jargon. And we get this problem, so we have this matrix, we construct partial transpose, and we study the spectrum. What does it mean, the simplest? Of course, to find the individual eigenvalues, it's hard. So we study the density of states, of course. And we would like to know to conclude that the matrix is positive definite or not, we have to just look at the support of this limiting measure. Then we will know that it is valid at least for large enough NAM. This is, in fact, the motivation to study the problem that I would like to study. And now, so we reduced the initial problem to this more or less standard setting of random matrix theory, which I would like to study. And here is a theorem saying, so let me, for those who know just a bit random matrix theory, looking at that object, you feel that the limiting distribution will be, okay, MP, let me say, because this is just standard distribution. But it turns out that not. The limiting density of states is a kind of semi-circle, but with a shift. So the theorem like that. You take the matrix that I wrote, you make the partial transpose, you assume that your entries are not necessarily Gaussian, just independent, identically distributed. with this normalization, and then you prove that with probability one, your counting measure tends to non-random limit, and this limit is absolutely continuous, and the corresponding density is given here. You see, without this subtraction, it will be just semicircle law, but there is a shift, and C, I remind you, C is just the like standard. This is the limiting ratio of this rectangular matrix of this of widths and heights. So this is a theorem, and it has certain history. This theorem first was proven by numerically by physicists who are working in quantum informatics. Excuse me, I am. Well, no. So this is a theorem. Now a bit of history. As I said, the first it was proven by physicists, no, just numerically. They just computed numerically the density of states of large matrices, and they found this shifted semicircle. Then there was a paper by Guillaume Abron from France, who proved for the Gaussian case using moments. So he was patient enough to compute all these moments of tensor products, etc. Eventually, he arrived at the conclusion. And myself, I just would like to present the more or less, I believe, simple and streamlined proof, which uses a standard means of random matrix theory.
I would like to just, go back and make sure I understand what you're proving.
Just density of states. I am proving.
I understand, but I'm not quite sure what the matrix is.
Okay. You start. Let's go back then. You take the just sample covariance, but tensor product, indexed by two indices. Standard sample covariance, just no alpha and beta. Yeah?
Okay.
And now you have this a bit more complex matrix. You have these two indices, and you interchange second indices. You see? This matrix with a sub-index tau is just you interchange the role alpha and beta. This is all. But no, it's just an integers. These are indices of entries.
How do you choose D1 and D2?
Any. No. I have to assume that they tend to infinity, of course. This is a random matrix theory, asymptotic result. I am not claiming something. No, in fact, it turns out that D1 and D2, do not appear separately. They enter only via the product D1, D2. And for the next, I will just assume that D1 equals D2, because no difference, in fact.
So what if I said
D1
equals
1? No, D1 equals 1, it is standard situation, it's sample covariance. No, I assume, of course, that both tends to infinity. But separately, they do not appear. Of course, you are right. No. Modulo this important point. Yes? OK. So Tom, now. Again, back?
Yeah, I go back. Let's see. So I just want to make sure I understand the matrix that you're looking at.
So here it is clear what is it.
Okay.
Now you just make the transposition with respect to Greek indices.
Okay.
This is two.
Okay. So that's
finished. And this is your matrix,
that's the matrix,
which is written here.
That's
you see? Yes. And it turns out that it is apparently innocent operation changes density of states drastically. So instead of MP, you have semicircle law, all the shift, with a shift. This is a point somehow, very strong change with starting from apparently simple operation. And this is interesting phenomenon, which, for myself is a bit, well, so this is a theorem. For example?
No.
What, for example, much simpler?
Just to prove that it is not PPT.
No, it's very hard to prove.
Really?
Yeah.
So this is the only way of proving it?
Yeah, most efficient and most...
What about just proving that it is always entangled with probability 1?
Nobody knows what how to prove entanglement directly.
Really? No.
Yeah, this is a question. So the yeah. So to conclude that it is not a tensor product, or you know, if the definition went out like that, if it is pure state, psi, just psi, so psi is entanglement it is if it is not tensor product. But if it is raw mixed states, then it is not convex linear combination of the project of rank one operators which are not entangled. And it is hard to find out what is it. And this is, it. For me, it was maybe when I started to think, for me, it is also a bit surprising. But it turns out that this simple observation by Peres is the most efficient criterion known so far. Well, now how to prove this. And now, conclusion. This is a conclusion. This is limiting distribution.
Now, under certain conditions, you're going to show it's entangled, but in other conditions, it's not.
No, but now it is simple. Since you see, you have here the support is evident. The support is a lambda minus C. Lambda minus C less or equal to square root of C minus 2 square root of C. And then you have to look here. And you find that C should be less than 4. And what is C? It is the sizes of the width and the height of this matrix X. So and you conclude that if these both numbers are large enough, then if you have this condition, then your state is entangled. Yeah, and this is a seems nice result, which I repeat, first was found numerically by certain physicists. Sorry? What is, no, no, why?
It
is entangled.
No,
yes. It is not believed. It is a simple theorem.
Ah.
No, nobody. No. Only in that direction. Well, now, Tom, can I go?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah?
So I just want to get the conclusion.
Yeah, no. That is, so you see, just instead of, excuse me, Marchenko posture, you have shifted semicircle. Yes. Wigner. But if it is about names, Wigner. Yes.
And this spectrum is independent of the way you
choose. No, it depends. In the sense that you have to assume that d1 and d2 both has to tend to infinity. But there is, I remind you that n is a product, d1 and d2. And it answers to the final, in final answer, you have only the product. This is somehow, this comes from the, in fact, random metric theory is mean field. If you're on mean field, the indices, they are more or less on the same footing. Well, this is if you want. Yeah, so the proof is very simple. But I just would like to use this opportunity to remind how do we prove the semicircle law. There are many proofs, but I will use certain proof which seems quite simple. So to make them simple, I will assume that the entries are Gaussian. General case also can be treated by a bit more sophisticated, but not too much technique. And it is known in random matrix theory. So I'll confine myself to the Gaussian case. So now I am about the standard situation. No tensor product, just standard matrices. So now I have just one index, a single index, not two. My God, I Ah, maybe. Okay. Page down and it is all. Okay, thanks. So now we are about usual sample covariance matrices. We have this rectangular data matrix. You write this product. You normalize properly. This is a normalization. And I would like to prove that I'm afraid that I am again ahead. Oh, first semicircle law. First, the semicircle law, this is just Wigner's theorem in the simplest setting. So I have a square matrix with Gaussian entries, Hermitian, and the modulo this condition, all the entries are independent. And this is normalization. And I would like to prove that the counting measure tends to this limit, which is given by famous Wigner formula. Doesn't work. Well, okay. So this is semicircle law. To remind you, but there is no shift. Wigner has no shift. Just this thing. Now, if we take the second, we have the previous matrix of Gaussian. This is quadratic in Gaussian with this normalization. And if we assume that the number of columns, the number of rows is tending to zero proportionally, then the limiting distribution is given by this formula. And you see that if C is small, then you have an atom and zero and something smooth. If C is bigger than one, you have only this one. And so it is, again, quite known already. And now how to prove these results? Just several simple facts. We pass from the measure. In our case, this is just counting measure normalized to its TTS transform, which is one-to-one with the measures because of this inversion formula. And I would like to use two simple facts about Gaussian random variables. Fact number one, it is integration by parts. If you have, or some mathematical physicists used to say that it's decoupling formula, yeah? So if you have the expectation of complex random variables Gaussian on some function phi, on it you can write in this form, just integration by parts. And the second, a bit less trivial, but not too much, if you have a function as here, and you put instead of arguments Gaussian random variables independent, then the variance of this function is also is bounded by something similar. Only here you have gradient squared. This is Poincaré, Chernov, Nash. There are many names. So I need only these results, and after that, I start from Poincaré. I define, I have a resolvent. If you take a trace of resolvent, because of spectral theorem, it will be precise this CTS transform of my measure. And I apply, I view this CTS transform as a function of all the entries. They are Gaussian. I apply Poincaré, and I arrive on very good bound. So you see, we have n squared, not n. This is mean field. Yeah, so we see that fluctuations are quite small, and because of that, it suffices to work with expectation, because we already get by Borel-Cantelli that if we will prove that the expectation will converge, then Gn itself will converge with probability one. Well, So, and again, to find the expectation, I use very simple mean. This is just resolvent identity. And I apply the operation 1 over n trace, which is here, an expectation. I get this relation where I have the product, g and w. W is Gaussian. G is a function of w. So apply integration by parts. And you this is integration by parts, you see. The derivative of the resolvent, it is just first order perturbation theory. And you'll get, so you, this is a result of just derivation. And if you plug this formula here in resolvent identity, you arrive to that relation. But now, because of vanishing of fluctuation, you replace the expectation of square by square of expectation, and you arrive to the quadratic equation. And quadratic, you solve the equation with this condition. Because this is TTS transform of positive measure, it has this property. And you obtain a formula for f, which after the applying inversion formula, you get semicircle. So this is all the story. And now, the same argument with a small difference, little difference, could be applied to the MP. So you do the same. You start from Poincaré, you get similar bound. Then you write resolvent identity. Now you have a bit different situation because for the Wigner case, you have G times something Gaussian. Now Wigner and two Gaussians. So, but you apply, for example, integration by part with respect to the second. This is how one can compute derivative. We get this formula. We plug the formula again here. And this is the thing. This is already good because the expectation of g by definition is f. But here you have a product of g, something which is not g. But again, from resolvent identity, you find that it is expressed via g. Again, you get g square, which you decouple by using Poincaré. And the resulting equation is here, again quadratic. Again, solve this equation, you get MP. So you see the more or less homogeneous line of arguments. Now let's apply something, this I skip. Let's apply something similar to the partial transpose. So again, I start by Poincaré and I get this bound like before. This allows me to occupy myself only by expectation. I write now again resolvent identity. I have a bit more mess here. So and I do once integration by part like I did in two previous cases. In both cases, you remember I once integrated by parts. In this already okay, in fact, gave me the result. But here it is not, since after first integration by part, I get something a bit strange, which you can't express via g itself. And after some reflection, it turns out that the situation is very simple. You have to be just a bit more patient. You have to integrate once more, twice, not once. And if you do this, what did you get? So again, I do integration by parts with respect to x bar. And this is the result. And the first thing will give you g square. And the second thing, it's a bit of work. It is small. And so what do we get? As a result, we get the shift. So it's finished, in fact. This is all the difference. So you have to be just a bit, never in my life in random metric theory, never integrated twice by parts. But turns out that sometimes you need. And this is all, yeah? So you get this result, which I mentioned. But this is only for the Gaussian case. Non-Gaussian case can be treated by similar technique, which is well known in random metric theory. I will not discuss this point. And you can prove that Okay, any IID in random variables will do, even not necessarily IID. And there was certain activity around this. There was, for example, a couple of papers by Banika and Ishita in which they proved that you can replace partial transpose more general, a certain class by linear maps. And nevertheless, and result will change, but not too much. You can still control the situation. And there was another line of activity coming mostly from information theory. This is Philippe Louboutin. They studied another class of matrices, random block matrices with random toplets blocks. And again, this block structure will change drastically density of states. There is certain things behind that myself I still don't understand completely, but certainly this operation, just partial, you know, if you have a tensor product or a block matrix and you do something on blocks, you can change so seriously density of states. This is general, so to say, conclusion which one can draw. I have still certain time. So now the second class, also coming from quantum informatics. But it is a bit different, yeah? Let us start. Let me write a formula. Let me remind you that the sample covariance matrix, this is a, you can write always like that. Yes? This is, you have this matrix N by M, and you multiply by conjugate. But it is more convenient for me if I write this matrix in the form, J tau, okay, tau, and I can look for fixed tau. We have a column, so it is sometimes convenient to view Mn as a sum of x alpha rank one operators, and these rank one operators, these are so corresponding vectors, just columns of the data matrix. The same. No. The difference is not the same. No. Yeah. And there are two most used classes of phis of random vectors. First, just random vectors with the dependent components. And second, a bit different, you assume that your vectors just uniformly distributed over the unit sphere, which are, by the way, related. It is well known that complex or rotational invariant complex or real Gaussian is related strongly to the uniform distribution. But this just a bit more complicated. Now, what do I do? In the standard situation, I have here the vectors which are just vectors. But now I replace every vector by tensor product of new vectors, more index. Before I had vectors with j, now there is j. So I, for every alpha and, so for every alpha, I have k vectors. And I do the tensor product, and these are my vectors phi that play the role of previous axis. I'll write in the moment the matrix form. And so now the dimension of our space is d to the power k, where d is the dimension of those vectors. Yes? And this is our matrix, which is similar to the sample covariance, but with the difference that now we have a tensor product structure. And it turns out that this matrix is, it's quite natural generalization of standard sample covariance matrices, but they appeared recently in a certain problem, less general than previous one about the entanglement, in the in the problem, this was a, there was a big paper, you see 50 pages by Hastings and co-authors, in which they studied a certain question of quantum informatics with a name whose origin I can't explain. But I can only say that it is a kind of quantum analog of standard problem with bins and balls. Excuse me, bins. This is not bills, bins. yeah. And just studying this thing, you arrive to again, to more or less standard problem of random matrix theory about the density of states, but for the matrix, which, as I said, more complex than standard sample covariance. And in this big paper, they used moments, Sasha, a lot of moments, and they proved that the limiting distribution is Marchenko-Pastur. And it is, on one side, it is more or less natural. On the other side, if you, on the other hand, if you just think a moment, you'll be a bit surprised, because let's compute the number of parameters roughly. So if you have a standard if you have this situation, how many, assume that phi are independent, then how many random parameters you have? You have d to the d times k. These are parameters that comes to the game. While if you take a generic vector, not a just standard, not just a tensor product like here, but just generic vector, general random vector in the tensor product, the number of parameters will be exponentially bigger. So it will be d to the power k. And despite that randomness rather poor here, we still have standard distribution, which is pertinent for the sample covariance matrices. And this is the result which I would like to prove. Again, as I said, this is already proven by moments. And the authors proved this result for two classes of vectors that I mentioned as phis, for the Gaussian and for the unit distributed over unit sphere. But the proof which I would like to just to outline works equally for any independent random variables. Moreover, for a certain class of dependent random vectors, independent vectors with dependent components. Like, okay, minimum dependence is if you take the vector uniformly distributed over the unit sphere. There is just one condition. And we feel that since it is just one condition, norm is one, if the vector has big dimension, it is not important, and it is indeed the case. But here, you can use more serious dependence. So the approach that I used before in the first part of my talk, it could work, but much, much longer than another approach which dates back to the idea that we used in our first paper with Marchenko. And I would like to just to remind you, in fact, this is a modern version that more or less updated version that we used in our paper with Alain Pajor, because we, at that paper we were interested by the case in which phi alone are vectors with long concave distribution. This is very important distribution in geometric analysis, in the structure of certain polytopes, etc. But it is not important at the moment. So I would like to present certain scheme which as efficient as the previous one, and they do not completely coincide, their applicability. Sometimes it's better to use the first, sometimes the second. So what is the toolkit? It's a bit different, but quite, again, very simple. First is called rank one perturbation formula. You have an arbitrary Hermitian matrix, and you add just rank one operator determined by some vector phi. And you're asking what is the resolvent of the sum. The resolvent of the sum is related to the resolvent of A by this formula. Just, okay, very simple calculation. And second is a bit more sophisticated, but not too much. This is the following. Assume that you have a M random variables, vector, whatever, independent random variables. In my case, these are, again, d-dimensional vectors. And you take certain function okay, the class C1 function of these variables, and you put instead of variables random vectors. And you can represent the variance of such a vector or such a function as a sum of, roughly speaking, I do the same at each term, I do the same, but only with respect to one variables. So it is just very simple scheme. Maybe it is not so, I shouldn't mention the name of God in vain, because it is not martingale, of course, theory, but it is main idea of martingale theory. You do it step by step. So this is an identity that allows you to work. Because since in that formula, you see, I do the serious operation only with respect to the one variables, and I can find the dependence of my R, and my R will be trace of G, the explicit dependence with respect to vector phi alpha by using this formula. Because you see, in that formula, from the point of view of probability of random matrix, G contains phi, G naught doesn't contain. Therefore, here you just separated the randomness in A and randomness in this randomness. And this is quite convenient. Well, and then, as I wrote here already, we just observe that our matrix. Now I am about just not, there is no tensor product. This is a scheme that works just for standard sample covariance. You write your matrix is a sum of projections or just rank one operators on the vectors of that form. And you again, you use either this martingale bound if they are, if phi I, phi alpha are arbitrary, or Poincaré if they are Gaussian. And you arrive to a weaker fact, but which is sufficient for the density of states. It suffices just to know that variance vanishes with n. This is all. Not necessarily to know the only thing that you have to, you will lose. In the previous theorems, every time I had the convergence with probability 1. Now I'll have convergence with probability. Of course, it is weaker, but nevertheless, the conditions are much weaker. Of course. No. It is uniform in that. You see, okay, in another slide, it is written that all the bounds, they are valid if imaginary part of Z is bigger than some eta, which is positive and non-random, fixed. So I am always, of course, this is important. This is good if you work, it suffices to have this if you work for the density of states, but of course, if you would like to study universality, it doesn't work. But nevertheless, here it is the case, yeah? And again, my love, just resolvent identity. I write again resolvent identity, and I use now, okay, that my perturbations, they are just rank one project operators, and I can write this formula, nothing serious, but now I use rank one to extract the dependence of G on phi alpha. And if you do this, you get here. So G alpha, it is just complete G, but without this particular vector of V alpha. So again, we separated, we made explicit dependence on the particular alpha, and after that, what is the idea? So since G alpha does depend on phi, let's first make the expectation with respect to that, and then we'll see what happened. In fact, everything, it will be very good. So what do we need? Let me show. We need, in fact, only two facts. The fact number one, that you can, I was a bit in hurry. The first fact, you have to know that if you have something here, not necessarily G alpha, any matrix that doesn't depend on phi alpha, and if you make the average with respect to this phi alpha, this will be the trace. No, okay, it is very simple property. If the vectors are independent, it suffices to know that the components phi j phi k expectation is just delta g k. These vectors in the geometric analysis, they call it isotropic. So they are more or less everywhere, yeah? But it is not sufficient, of course, to replace. So if we have this property, we can replace here by trace. But to justify this, you have to know that fluctuations are small, yeah? So you need to know something about the fluctuations. And this is what you need to know, yes? So you need to know, in fact, it is strong condition. I need much less. In fact, I need the condition that the variance of any of quadratic form, it is bounded by norm of A times, and delta is just tends to zero with any rate. And this is, it suffices to know. And in that paper that I mentioned with Pajor, we call these vectors good. So of course, the vectors with independent components are good, and it is easy to prove just one line. But for example, if you take the vectors in which we were interested in, these are vectors with log concave distribution. For them, this is a quite serious result recent, 3 years ago by Boas Klartak, that if you have long concave distribution, that the variance of quadratic form vanishes. And the first work was just little on one, and the second paper was, as far as I remember, this was the best known now is something like 1/3, Sasha? Or, yeah. So it is not like, so, and this requires, this is indeed hard work. So, but for us, just knowing that the vector is good, we are able to do the job because I am back. So you just replace this quadratic form by its expectation with respect to phi alpha. And since your vector are isotropic, they do not fluctuate, of course, you can justify this replacement. And after that, you obtain, if you do this replacement, you'll get instead, you'll get instead G alpha, phi alpha, you'll get just the 1/n trace G alpha. But you need not G alpha, but G itself. But again, by using rank one perturbation formula, it is easy to show that 1/n trace G minus 1/n trace G alpha is again, of course, imaginary part Z should be uniformly bounded away from the real axis. So you have first, when you replace this by expectation, you'll get the trace of this matrix, this resolvent. Now you replace G alpha by G, and you obtain again, you obtain this equation. There should be Fn here. And just passing to the limit, you'll get again quadratic equation coinciding with the previous one. So this is a scheme. And it turns out, if you just analyze once more, I am repeating what I said. To apply this scheme, we need to know two facts. First, that our vector, doesn't matter what is the dimension, is isotropic. And second, that it is good. That means that the variance of this quadratic form vanishes as n tends to infinity. And now there is just, you use this scheme, which we worked out with Pajor. And you have to add to this scheme just the following lemma. Lemma is the following. Assume that you have k random identically distributed vectors, and you know that every vector is good, then the tensor product is also good. And this is again martingales. You do just by induction, step by step, averaging with respect to every of them. And you are done. Okay. This is a proof, but it is in fact simple. Okay, I finished.